Hey folks, Matt from artoftheimage.com. We've got a viewer writing in. This is Amanda. Heading of this email is Lens Arsenal Help for the Nikon D5500. So Nikon D5500, down the food chain from the 7000 series, small, compact, very solidly built little camera with a full vari-angle LCD, so it's a big advantage over the 7000 series. She says, "Hi Matt, I recently just stumbled upon your channel after joining a Nikon Australia Facebook group, and what an absolute gem your channel and content is. I was hoping to reach out to you as I had a question which I'm just really hoping you can help me out with, and that is I want to update, add to my lens arsenal, brackets, which is a little to nothing at the moment, for my Nikon D5500. I currently only have my 18-140 f3.5-5.6 ED VR AFS kit lens. I'm currently undergoing my bachelor in interior architecture, so I tend to do a fair bit of architecture scale model photography to complement my work at the university. However, I also would love a lens to travel with that's versatile enough for holiday shots, portraits, street and landscape, that's ideally not as heavy as my current kit lens, if possible. I'm also actually thinking of starting my own YouTube channel, which may include vlogging. So a lens that would suit that is not that is not so noisy would be ideal as well." So we've got a couple of different purposes here, a couple of different things we're looking for in a lens. "I'm extremely conflicted at the moment as well because I purchased anything I tend to overload myself with research that almost makes it harder for me to choose what I want with all the possible lens combinations out there, as well as conflicting reviews. Another thing that I've heard is that Nikon cameras seem to lack in the video department, so I've even been tossing up moving to a potential DSLR, Canon 80D or Canon T7i 800D being the ones that I've looked into the most. But I'm not sure if there's a way around it with a lens that will help me with what I want. The potential lenses I'm looking into are," and then she's got brackets, "if you have any other suggestions, please feel free to let me know. Primes, the Nikon 35 f1.8G AFS DX, the Nikon 50mm f1.8G AFS." And she says, "I tested both these lenses out the other day, and for some strange reason, it seems the 50 seemed a fair bit brighter in comparison to the 35. But I also love the idea of the wider 35, so I'm also very conflicted. Also, tossing up a potential wide-angle prime, 20-24, if you have any suggestions. Wide-angle lens, potential for vlogging. Tokina 11-16 f2.8, Tokina 11-20 f2.8, and the Tamron 10-24 f3.5-4.5, and then a walk around, the Sigma 17-50 or 17-70, or the Tamron 17-50, 17-70. Gosh, so sorry that was so much longer than I anticipated. Hope you're able to help me out as I once... Once I get some lenses sorted, I'm hoping to pick up your cheat sheets to the dedicated lenses too. Thank you so much for your time if you read this far, let alone if you choose to respond to me. Cheers, Amanda." Well, thanks for your question, Amanda. Good question. I think a lot of people get into this position where they start to outgrow the kit lens. You buy a DSLR, comes with a kit lens, you're excited about it, you use it, and you're shooting it for a while, and then you start to see other people's photos, you start to wonder what these other lenses can do, and you've got some other needs, namely the architecture here. So my thought is, based on the architecture, the wide would be good for vlogging and for architecture. I would suggest the Nikon AFP DX Nikkor 10-20 f4.5-5.6G VR. So that's a bit of a mouthful, but that essentially is around $300. I'll put a link below. You can check it out. It's an OEM lens. It's a great performer. It's probably your best bet on price there. When you're shooting wide there, a 4.5 versus a 2.8, I don't think you're going to notice a whole bunch of difference. I think what you might notice is the Tokinas aren't that sharp wide open, so you're going to be a little disappointed if you're thinking, "I'm going to shoot a Tokina at f2.8 and I'm going to use it there." I think you're going to find it a little too, you have to stop it down. Whereas at Nikon, you shoot that wide open, you'll be fine right out of the gate there with the f4.5. That would be my suggestion. The only one that I would consider as a step up to that would be the Sigma 8-16 in the Nikon range. The Sigma 8-16 is a phenomenal lens. It's a little wider. It's very good, and I really like it. A little more expensive, though. Again, I'll put a link below. When I said in the Nikon range, I mean in the sense of if you did switch to Canon, the 10-18 is a phenomenal little lens, and then the, what is it, the 11-22, I think it is, for the M series. You see me shoot that on the Canon M50. It's a nice little lens, too. I think I'd probably still, You know, if I was getting an M series camera right now, the M50, I would definitely get an adapter. So I think I'd still just buy the Canon 10 to 18 and save the money. So I kind of jumped to the second part and addressed your wide angles first, but that'll address your architecture. And frankly, the 8 to 16 will be more beneficial for architecture because it's a very nice lens, and you'd be surprised how much what seems like a little bit, 8 mils versus 10, on the wide end, especially on a DX camera like the D5500, you're going to find that really is a lot wider, that extra 2 mils. For primes, addressing your question about one's brighter than the other, that should not be the case. They're both f1.8 lenses. Now, did you check to see that your shutter speed and your ISO were the same with both lenses? Because that may have been what happened, whether you intentionally or unintentionally did it. Perhaps the ISO was set lower or the shutter speed was set higher when you put the 35 on, in which case it didn't seem as bright at f1.8. Because really, they're both f1.8 lenses. They should be just as bright. And frankly, you should be able to hand hold the 35 f1.8 at a lower shutter speed than you should at the 50 because of our, you know, the old rule of thumb. In the old film days, it was 1 over the length, the focal length of your lens. So 1 over 50 would be the closest to would be 1 over 60. But then you add the multipliers on for a DX sensor because that does, you know, you're getting that extra focal length. So you kind of got to use that comparable focal length, the focal length of the lens with the crop sensor factor applied, so our effective field of view in comparison to 35 mil terms. So considering that's close to an 80, you're going to want to shoot that 1 over 80 on the Nikon 50 mil. And some people who have shaky hands, even higher shutter speed just to keep it not shaking. That's the advantage of a camera with in-body stabilization, which unfortunately the 5500 does not. We're hoping the new full frames will have that from Nikon. See, so the 35 mil, you could probably get away, if you have really steady hands, maybe get away with shooting it at 1 over 40. 1 over 60 you should be okay with if you're pretty steady. But again, it should allow you a little slower shutter speed. So with all else being equal, there should be no reason that the 50 was brighter than the 35. Walk-around lens, probably, I don't know, your 18 to 40 is a great walk-around lens. If you're looking for something faster, I don't have a good history with Tamron in those primes that are not primes, those zooms. That's 17 to 50 f2.8. I've owned it both for Nikon and for Canon. I couldn't get a sharp one at f2.8 and I sent it back. I had dialed in, it still came back. Center was terrible at f2.8. So I just don't have any, you know, my own personal experience with the Tamron was not good. On the other hand, the Sigma 17 to 50 f2.8 OS, fantastic lens. It's my go-to lens if I'm shooting a DX or crop sensor body, both on Canon and Nikon. If I want to do an event work or something like that, like weddings where I need a fast zoom, so an f2.8 zoom, the Sigma 17 to 50 is the go-to lens. I like it better than both OEM products, both the Nikon and Canon versions, and it's a much better deal as well. Very sharp, very good performing lens. However, the Sigma 17 to 70 is a bit of a compromise. Not quite as fast. It's a 2.8 to 4. I would shoot it myself as just a constant aperture f4, which is fine with me, especially with a good performing high ISO body like the D5500. But the gives you a bit more range. You got 70 mils on the long end. But like I said, unless you need the speed, your 18 to 140 kit lens is probably the better walk around lens. You lose 1 millimeter on the wide, but you're looking at getting a wide angle anyways. 1 millimeter is nothing really to. At 17, it's not a lot. At 8 to 10, it is. At the 70 mil range to go to 140, it's a much nicer, more convenient walk-around lens. Walk-around lens typically don't need a fast lens. If you're looking for something where you do need a faster lens, then definitely I would go with the 17 to 70 f2.8 OS. Hope that helps you out, Amanda. If you're doing a lot of video and doing vlogging, yeah, I would get the T7i or the 80D, preferably probably the 80D. You may even want to look at the SL2. It's basically a baby 80D for less money and does pretty much everything the 80D does. Great vlogging camera because it's small and lightweight, uses all the same lenses. And then there's like a whole trifecta of great lenses for that. I like the 18 to 135. These are my best value lenses for Canon. You've heard me say this before, but the 18 to 135, the 55 to 250, the 50 f1.8 STM, and then the 10 to 18. Fantastic lenses. If you can get one of the deals on the M50s right now, definitely might want to consider that. I think they were around $600. I'll put a link below. I'm not sure what the price is right now, but it was the camera plus the kit lens, and there was a deal on them, a sale on them. So check it out. That is a fantastic little camera, great for vlogging, great photography camera, and with the M adapter, you can get into all those other lenses as well. So my preference probably would be either the SL2 or the M50 at this point in time. Not that I don't like the 80D, but the M50 offers some advantages, namely 4K, smaller, lighter, cooler looking too. It's just the way things are going with mirrorless. As far as, let me see, did we hit all your points? I think we did. Let me throw it back to our viewers. What do you guys think? Do you agree with me about if you're going to be vlogging, shooting video, probably a good idea to switch over to Canon? The big thing there is you're going to get dual pixel AF. Not that the D5500 can't do good video, but if you're vlogging, you're going to be very disappointed with the ability of the camera to follow you smoothly and accurately, whereas the SL2 does that wonderfully. The 80D does that wonderfully with the dual pixel AF from Canon. The M50 does it wonderfully in 1080. Doesn't do it in 4K, but you know, you got the advantages of still having 4K. So that's why I would probably, out of all those at the moment, if price, and again, they've been on sale, so the M50 is a good way to go. But what would you guys do? What camera would you pick there? Would you switch to Canon? As far as the lenses, I was going over there, which lens would you go with? As far as the 35 versus the 50, they should be, as I said, both just as bright. It's just a personal preference. I like the 50 for shooting more portraits because its effective field of view is about 75 mils on the Nikon, about 80 on the Canon, if you're shooting a Canon 50. So it gives you a very close to a traditional 85 mil portrait lens. So then it just becomes try them out and see which one you like to shoot at, the focal length. And then wide angles and the walk around lenses. Let us know what you guys have to say in the comments below. What would you do? Let's help Amanda out. Always great to hear your feedback as well in these situations, so our viewers, when they're trying to consider what to buy or switching, they can get more rounded, various opinions. And some of you bring up stuff that I didn't think of myself. So thanks for tuning in. Thanks for your question, Amanda. Stay tuned. We'll be back soon here at artoftheimage.com.